right, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Welcome to the Nelson-Atkins Museum of Art. My name is Adam Johnson. I'm the Assistant Director of Education and Public Programs, and I'm pleased to see you tonight. We are geared up to celebrate all things Asia this week. Asian culture, Asian art, of course. It culminates this Sunday with what event? Very, very, very good. Yeah, for those of you who don't know, our biggest event of the entire year celebrates our wonderful Chinese collection and the culture and the performance and the art of this great civilization. And it is, of course, a really remarkable event here at the museum. So definitely mark your calendars to come back on Sunday. Tonight, though, our attention is turned to India and to Southeast Asia. And I've got the pleasure of introducing my colleague, Kimberly Masteller. Kimberly is the Jeanne McCray Beals Curator of South and Southeast Asian Art here at the Nelson-Atkins. From 2002 to 2008, she held the position of Assistant Curator of Islamic and later Indian Art at the Harvard Art Museums. Masteller has curated many exhibitions here at the museum. Some of these should be really familiar, including Revealing a Hidden Treasure, a Jain Shrine from India, and this is currently on view upstairs in Gallery 203. In 2013, she curated Echoes, Islamic Art and Contemporary Artists. She also co-curated the traveling exhibitions Roads of Arabia, Archaeology and the History of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and way back in 2009, soon after she arrived, here at the museum from the land of the Taj Mahal, Paintings for India's Mughal Emperors from the Chester Beatty Library. Masteller is a PhD candidate at The Ohio State University and is a recipient of grants from the Fulbright Fellowship Program and the Social Science Research Council. Masteller's most recent project is publishing the catalog that shares its title with tonight's talk, Masterpieces of Indian and Southeast Asian Art, which came out in late 2016. It is available in the museum store. I like holding things up here, but I'm not sure that you can see them. Please check this out at the museum store. It's a wonderful publication. It highlights the greatest works in our collections that Kimberly oversees. To discuss a selection of these objects tonight, live and in person, please join me in welcoming to the stage Kimberly Masteller.
Good evening. Oh, it's great to see all of you here tonight. And it's for a subject that is near and dear to my heart. We're going to go on a journey tonight, a journey to Asia, and a journey through the art of South Asia with a brief sojourn to Southeast Asia in the talk. And this art, I believe, represents some of the world's greatest art, the greatest, most beautiful, most transcendent art that has ever been developed. Now, you may say, well, she's probably got a bias. But it's my aim tonight to bring you all to the same opinion. You might think I've got my work cut out for me, but as you study these works closely tonight, like the sculpture you have on the screen now, I think they'll make that case all on their own. So what is my role? I have a very small role with you tonight. It's my intention to frame these wonderful works of art through discussions of their visual style, their symbolism, their function, and their context, to provide the kind of what, why, how, when, and where of their being. As a museum curator, I was trained from when I was just a little curator, like that big. I was trained to look for particular qualities in works of art that make them special, because this is the question you always get. There's a lot of art out there that you see in different places and museums and antiques roadshow and all sorts of places. And so you always get asked, well, what is it that makes it special? What is it that makes it a museum quality object that elevates it? And what is it that makes that a step better? What makes it a masterpiece? So So for Asian art, we're going to look at the kind of curatorial museum qualities. We're going to, and what we were trained to look for, quality in a work of art. And by quality, that means a lot of things. It can mean its visual style, its skill of manufacture, how well was it crafted, how well what care the artist put into it, what was the accomplishment of the artist, and its presence. Some works of art have a presence, and some don't, at least in the opinion of a curator trained in the 20th century. Condition. What shape is that work of art in today that might be nearly 1,000 years old? And does its current condition in any way deter from your experience of it? And what's its rarity? How common is the work? And if it's a common type, how common is it in the version that you see before you in that condition? Finally, the thing that we look for as a curator is importance. What is the work's contribution, its defining role, to the history of art? And in the case of the traveling shrine, which we'll look at tonight in a few minutes, what is that individual work's role in the history of an entire religion and its movement across Asia? I'm setting you up for that one. So I think you'll see that the works we look at tonight, and it was very hard to choose a small group from the small group that's in the book, but I think you'll see that they hit these qualities in spades. So I hope you'll enjoy looking at them. I will tell you, I will be providing a lot of supporting information, like you see on the next slide, maps, some text to help frame and identify the object. There's a lot of text. But don't worry, because there's no test afterwards. Our goal for the evening instead is transformation. And so with that, let us begin our conversation. And I will start with this work. This is, I'm going to turn the mic this way so I can look at you and look at it while I speak. This is an early masterpiece of Buddhist art. Buddhism, as you all know, it's a religion that developed in India. We associated, or at least with the current teachings, with the last historical Buddha, Shakyamuni, who lived in the 6th century before the turn of the Common Era. But we don't see depictions of Shakyamuni himself in the earliest forms of Buddhist art, and we really see them around the 1st and 2nd centuries of our Common Era, centuries after his passing. And one of the areas of the world where we see incredible development of Buddhist art with many, many rich depictions of Buddhas, including Shakyamuni, and I'll get to the plural of what I mean by that later in the discussion, actually very early in the discussion. But we see incredible Buddhist art coming out of what used to be called the northwest frontier of India, what is now Pakistan and Afghanistan. So let's take a look at this work closely. This is a relief sculpture. It is from Pakistan. It's about 36 inches or so wide. It's on view in our galleries, but I wanted to give you, so you can kind of picture this. Where are works like this found? Because we see lots of fragments from this part of the world, fragmentary sculpture, but to give you a sense of its context, reliefs like these were probably, almost all of them were created to ornament Buddhist monasteries, in particular the base and the drum, meaning the bottom part of architectural objects like this. This is a stupa, which is a reliquary mound, and this was a necessary component that you would find in early Buddhist monasteries in India, and as Buddhism spread out of India through the Himalayan passes into to the Northwest. So you see in this archaeological photograph here of a restored stupa where you might find relief carvings like the one in our collection. So one of the first questions I'm always asked when we talk about this sculpture, particularly with students, is why does the Buddha look like that? And why is he wearing a toga? And that's not just a joke, and students are often surprised to find that out, but that's actually true, that the Buddha's dress is based on the Hellenistic world, and that's because this period, when these sculptures are being created, these monasteries are being built and patronized, the area, what is called ancient Gandhara, here in was ruled just at the turn of and before the turn of the Common Era by Greek kingdoms. It's part of Alexander's empire. And they left small Greek kind of trading colonies run by Greeks who brought Greek tastes, Greek coinage, Greek deities, Greek customs to the area. And then that was taken over later by the Romans, who also established colonies in these same passes along trade routes coming outside of India. So we have a lot of what we would call Hellenistic art and Hellenistic culture that becomes kind of foundational when this group comes in here on the right. The Kushans, which were actually a nomadic group from Central Asia that get pushed out of Western China, pushed west, as the Han Dynasty in China expands. So they move along the Silk Road and they figure, you know, this is a pretty good deal because as we take over parts of the Silk Road, then we can charge taxes at each stop. We're becoming very wealthy. And so they move along the Silk Road down into India. And this becomes their heartland, their capital. The Kushans become Buddhist. And they patronize a Buddhist art that develops in this part of the world that then is somewhat hybrid, and it combines these elements of Western art. And some of them are really easy to spot. Like here, this is a relief from the British Museum, and look at this fellow, one of the attendants to the seated Buddha. Look familiar? He absolutely is Hercules. And they took the form of Hercules to embody the qualities of a bodhisattva, an enlightened being who is an attendant to the Buddha, of Vajrapani, who is this meant to be the strong protector of the Buddha and of Buddhism. And how do you depict strong in the ancient world? With Hercules. And if you want to see that in our sculpture, here's our wonderful print. Here's an ancient bronze Hercules that was excavated at Bagram in Afghanistan. And here's our Vajrapani with his back turned to us, showing off his rippling muscles in our relief. So when I got here, there was already a scholarly debate going on about who was depicted in this relief. What Buddha does it depict? And there's enough evidence, and I'll show you some of that evidence, to identify the scene and who the figures are. So this is not Shakyamuni, but this is a Buddha who was believed to have lived in the distant past. His name is Dipankara, and he was an earthly Buddha back in history before Shakyamuni was born. He has a very important role, even in early Buddhism, because he is a character, an actor, in a series of Buddhist tales known as the Jataka tales. And these are stories, oftentimes set as fables, of the past lives of Shakyamuni and what he learned and what his deeds were in episodes from each of these lives, which then helped him advance in the next lifetime spiritually until his final life on earth when he became a Buddha. So all Buddhas are depicted in a similar way, similar iconography, ascetic robes, if it's early Buddhism. So they're hard to tell apart. But we know it's Dipankara because of the other figures that are depicted with him. And the key figure in this narrative is actually the most subservient, this small little ascetic at the bottom of the relief who is kneeling before the feet of Dipankara. And I mean, I love this sculpture. Not only is it really three-dimensional, it's got a lot of volume, a lot of flesh, a lot of mass of the figures, very deeply carved. But look at this arm. And look how they rendered, just by little engraving of lines, that beautiful curving fingers into the stone beneath the base, breaking the picture plane. Just so delicate. But here he is bowing. His name, depending on the version of the story, is either Mega or Sumedha. And he's an ascetic who hears the rumors that Dipankara is coming to their village. The Buddha is walking there. So he and the rest of the townsfolk, the princes, the nobles, everybody rushes to see him. He takes bundles of flowers with him that he gets from a young girl to offer to the Buddha. And when the Buddha approaches, he sees that there's this big kind of trail of mud. There's a stream bed, and it's all muddy. And the Buddha would be walking through the mud. And so it's very much like the European chivalry stories. He throws down his hair for the Buddha to walk on, to walk over the mud. And at that moment, Dipankara looks down. He recognizes in him that this being, the soul of this ascetic, will one day become a Buddha, and he makes that prediction. So the scene is incredibly important to early Buddhism because it predicts the future birth of Shakyamuni. Here are two other versions of the scene, and this is how we can clarify what we're looking at. From the British Museum here, and you can see his hair extending here beneath the Buddha's feet. And from the Met, here as well. Now, I could play a game. Which one does it better? And maybe we can play that, but it's not my goal tonight. But it's an incredible image. And ours even has this wonderful waving stream, the muddy stream bank that cuts diagonally through the composition, nailing what the scene depicts. And we'll move on now to the art of the Gupta period. What I kind of am presenting to you is a period of artwork where the court style, what became the official style, is interested in beauty and perfection in a way that we hadn't seen in India before. This is a period that often gets called by historians a golden age. It's probably one of many golden ages in the history of India. But it gets called that for, I think, some fair reasons, because we have at this period a large indigenous kind of empire develop in North India, the Guptas. They will rule from the Gangetic Plain. Well, go back. Here. But they have two major art centers, one Sarnath, which is here on the Ganges River outside of the city of Varanasi, another major art producing center here at Mathura. So if you think Delhi is here, Taj Mahal's just below it, here is Mathura. And it was an incredibly important site, both for Hinduism and Buddhism in the ancient world. But the Guptas not only patronized art and get their nobles and foster a community of patronage for the arts and religious art, but they also patronized poetry, science, literature. It's one of the great periods of the development of knowledge, and it's often compared to classical Greece. So, the sculpture that we have standing in the gallery upstairs from Mathura, you can recognize it from its speckled red sandstone, what I think is an absolutely stunning material, because it has this warm color, this color, the redness, it kind of reminds you of the pinkness of flesh. The speckling gives it a bit of a visual variation. It's natural to the stone in Mathura, and it's soft. And so it's an incredible material, and we'll actually see sandstone in several of the works tonight for displaying flesh and the human form. There's something very natural, very living about this stone. And Mathura has incredibly famous sculptural school, and under the Guptas, they developed some really incredible work. And so this is, I think, a really good comparison to our sculpture here. This is in the museum at Mathura, and he is complete, the Jamalpur Buddha. And so the difference here is that he has his head and this wonderful ornate halo behind him, but you can see that the body type is similar. The material is similar. The style and even the way that they drape the figure with this almost transparent drapery, so the body just pushes through, and if it weren't for the folds, you might not even notice that he's wearing clothing. These are all elements that developed in this school. So if our figure had his head still, it would probably look something like this, the Jamalpur Buddha with a very serene appearance and this kind of wide oval head, full face, rings of fat on his neck that becomes a Gupta stylistic trait, the partially closed eyes, the downward meditative appearance, and we're going to see this again. So it's not just in sculpture that we see these innovations, this body type. This becomes standard for a lot of the art that's produced during the Gupta era. So some of you may be familiar with the painting I'm comparing it to on the right. This is a painting from the Ajanta Caves, produced really kind of at the end of Gupta rule, patronized by another dynasty, but in that court style. And you can see that across the arts, they shared similar traits. They followed a canon of proportions, just like the sculptors did in ancient Greece. They developed what is the ideal body type. And for the Guptas, it was these wonderful wide shoulders, and they're rounded. And their texts tell us they were supposed to be like elephant trunks that kind of bend as they curve from the head of the elephant down. The eyes, the eyebrows, are supposed to be like the bend in a bow. And so they take these abstract ideas. The lips are pursed like lotus buds that have just about to open. So that, what are these beautiful images that then they sew together, they stitch them together to make the body type, to make the form. And Lawrence Sickman, you know, our famous director and first curator of Asian art, talked about this sculpture in an article, and he said, Gupta proportions are not those of mortal and imperfect humanity, but are ideally conceived and set by iconic canon. And he was right. For comparison, we have another Gupta sculpture upstairs in the galleries. This one is produced in Sarnath, the site along the Ganga, the Ganges River, and you'll see it's slightly different. No pleats in the clothing, so he looks almost nude. Similar shape. In this standing figure, though, the Buddha has a slight sway to his body. And that takes us to the last Gupta piece I'm going to show you, but it's a knockout. This is a small bronze sculpture. He's about 14 inches high in our collection, and he's probably the most important of all three of these works. Bronzes of high quality, ancient bronzes, are exceedingly rare because bronze gets melted down, it gets damaged. This piece was excavated in central India in the 19th century, and one of three works that was discovered. The museum purchased it from the heirs of the archaeologist in England in 1944. The piece is quite stunning. I think you'll see some of the same exact traits that we see in the stone sculpture are carried over to the bronze. And the way the proportions are set, even how in this tiny little bronze they got these kind of bird-shaped, half-closed eyes, the pursed lips, incredible control of the material and the casting. Here you see similar treatment in the proportions of the body, and look at that wonderful curve. There's the sway. And you know what's interesting about this? This is so Indian, right? He doesn't look Roman or Greek at all, right? This is something different. Till you look at this. Do any of you know where the pose comes from? My fellow senators. Thank you, I wasn't going to say that part. it's a Roman toga, and that's the pose for how you hold the drapery, the end piece of the toga. So even in this most Indian of sculptures, it still hearkens to Rome. Now we'll follow Buddhist art as it takes a journey. And some of you, like perhaps Colin, might dispute, hey, that should be in my talk, not yours. Thank you. Thank you. Because this piece has been a fight in the museum, not between Colin and I, but really just where does it belong since it entered the collection in the 1940s. And this is because we're not sure. And that's what makes it so interesting. So according to our records, what Lawrence Sickman has passed down to us, the piece, it came from a dealer in New Delhi. He acquired it while he was stationed there in the war. He had seen it in the 1930s at the same dealer, and he told one of our docents in an interview that when he went back, 10 years later, it was in the same corner, in the same spot, as if it had been waiting for him. He acquired it. The story was that it had been in the collection of Stella Cromrich, who was a very important early art historian, who European, who lived in India and Nepal, and then came to the U.S. and became the curator at the MFA in Boston. very important scholar, and that she had acquired it in Nepal. It has a Tibetan inscription on the back that is partially worn, but likely says Bodhisattva. But I can confirm for you that this was not made and did not come from Delhi, from Nepal, or from Tibet. So what is it, and how did it get around? And that's a great part of the story. So here's our map for this section. You see we have some guesses. So here's India, Delhi, it's not from there. Tibet, no. But it has very important visual roots, art historical roots, from Kashmir. It's possible that it came from Kashmir in North India. And notice the trade routes that take you right out of Kashmir here. Srinagar makes it look very easy on a map to do that. And here's the Tarim and the Basin the Central Asian Silk Roads. And you know there are two routes, a northern route and a southern route. Two sites of incredible importance to this work's history and what people are researching are Khotan and Kucha on the northern route, Khotan on the southern route. And then we're going to look at some comparative works from Dengwang, the farthest kind of the Western China site, where they have those hundreds of caves with thousands of Buddhist paintings, a monastery and a library that preserved thousands of documents. We're not going to look at all of them. But so what does the shrine depict? We have the central panel I'll keep bringing up for you here, but it depicts a central Buddha seated. We know who this is. This is a Buddha named Vairochana. Vairochana is the universal Buddha. It's a form of Buddhism, a deity that develops a little bit later in Buddhism, what we call the Mahayana school of Buddhism. And he is the closest thing in Buddhism to a big G god. He, in the texts and the traditions that are associated with him, see him as this universal being radiating light, that Buddhas and world systems emerge from his body, that he is this creator that things come from. So in traditions associated with him, he is of central, utmost importance. And you can see that Vairochana had a very important role along the Silk Road. This is a mandala that depicts him in the center, in the drawing on the right. This was probably a 9th century drawing that was discovered at Dengwang. And I would say that this arrangement with the central Buddha surrounded by bodhisattvas is a mandala, a kind of mandala, a cosmic diagram that depicts kind of a conceptual universe. So the emanator of a mandala is in the center, that's Vairochana Buddha here in both of these, and then the attendants and the deities that are one step out that relate to that Buddha, that support that Buddha, are the innermost circle around them. And this I thought was stunning. Near Dengwang are a group of caves called the Yulin Caves. And this I wanted to show you because of the relationship of these figures, the 8 bodhisattvas to Vairochana. Here we have a wall mural in a cave with Vairochana. And notice, same exact pose, same throne underneath with lions. And then we're missing 4 bodhisattvas to the right, but here are 4 of the identical group that we see in our shrine. When you wonder how Buddhism traveled thousands of miles from India through the mountains to China, it's in with objects like this, carried by monks who followed these teachings and who could teach others. So what was this traveling shrine used for? Well, I think it was used for worship, for devotion. And we have a lot of material, whether it's very few shrines, but a lot of material in the form of paintings, particularly from Dungwang, that survived, that clue us into this. So here's a mandala, this time of the Bodhisattva Guanyin, or Avalokiteshvara. And you can see the cosmic diagram with the figures who support it. Up at the top, actually, is another group of Buddhist deities. Here's Vairochana, the universal Buddha in the center. But look at the bottom. Do you see this man in black robes and what look like children? And a woman, this is his wife, those are his children, and a monk. These are the people who commissioned this object and who used it for devotion to pray and do prayers and devotion to the deities, and for the monk or someone who's initiated to meditate on the mandala. So now look at the bottom of our shrine. Do you see this fellow? Do you see the bodhisattva here who's touching his head? Another one that appears to be offering or perhaps pouring something on his head? This is the man whom this shrine was intended for. We know from this he was a monk. You can see that by his shorn hair and his red robes, his costume. He sits kneeling in kind of a prayer posture on a rug. And it looks like he's having some sort of blessing, perhaps an initiation, being given to him in this vision by the bodhisattvas above him. One of the things our conservation team has just noticed, and we're working with a scientist studying this piece, do you see how there's a different piece of wood here that was inserted, but it appears to be carved in a similar way? One theory we have is that perhaps the shrine was made, but not completed until they had a buyer or a patron, and then they finished it. So where was the Nelson-Atkins Shrine from? Oh, that's a good question. That's our problem, right? So this is a Kashmiri shrine in an Indian collection. It's wood and ivory. Now, it's from at least a century earlier. And so you see it's different in style. But it's different enough, even though there are things about our shrine, these figures that look Kashmiri, they're not quite the same. Our shrine looks an awful lot like this one that was recently kind of discovered in a private collection in Europe. And one author has suggested that if you look at them, they're so similar, this could be made by the same workshop. This author attributes this shrine to Khotan or Kucha in Central Asia. But there are some differences. The scroll work in the back, there are some things that are different between them. And I'll leave you with one other bit of food for thought, looking at the work from Khotan. Look at the face of this small terracotta figure with the face of our central Buddha. We know in Khotan they were very interested in the cult of these eight bodhisattvas. And Khotan is an incredible place where cultures came together. For among their murals, we find Hindu gods like this depiction of Shiva. And that will take us to our next piece. Probably the best known or favorite sculpture in the department is our large bronze sculpture of Shiva as Nataraja, the Lord of Dance, created in South India, probably the early 13th century, during the Chola dynasty. And Chola bronzes are internationally famous works of art, and we'll talk about why in a few minutes. But I wanted to tell you a bit about the context for these. The Cholas are an incredibly powerful dynasty from the 9th through the 13th centuries, and they will move from this area and establish a capital here at a city called Tanjore, or Tanjore. And then, and it looks like my map has moved because this city is now in the ocean, but the dot should be right here. After they expanded down to Tanjore for their capital, they then built this, they then had control over this temple, this sacred temple city called Chidambaram. And Chidambaram was incredibly important because this was the place where not just Shiva was worshipped and important, but a very special form of Shiva, Shiva as the Lord of the Dance. He was the local god, the local form of Shiva of Chidambaram, who was said to dance in the gardens and the groves and the cemeteries around the city. And so this form was already important, but after it became a city under the imperial Cholas, it became an imperial emblem. So the Cholas go back to Tanjore after they invade Sri Lanka. They're incredibly wealthy. They build an incredible capital city with this state temple here, this temple to Shiva that's over 200 feet in height. At the time it was constructed, it was the tallest architecture, contemporary architecture, constructed in the world, taller than the cathedrals in Europe at this time. And they're not made out of granite. Just saying. Not easy. And with their wealth and their resources, they began to fill these temples with incredible bronze sculptures in the sub-shrines of the temples. And so these are the Chola bronzes. And, you know, if you're lucky enough to see one in a temple, you know, it's just one. There's one shrine for Nataraja. But if you go to Tanjore, to the Tanjore Museum, which is in a former palace, there's a whole gallery of imperial Chola Natarajas. So they're one of our patrons and volunteers here, Tony Batchelor, says you go in there and it looks like the Rockettes. It's pretty amazing. And look at them. You can tell just between these two the difference in the style. So they're not all alike. Each school had its own style. And so you can trace them across the landscape and through time. So here's ours upstairs. Look how alert it is. And look how benevolent and friendly he appears. Wide awake. And yet somehow he doesn't seem uncomfortable striking this pose. So what does the pose mean? The iconography was kind of decoded by Ananda Kumaraswamy. Cromrich went to Philadelphia Museum. Kumaraswamy, a very famous early art historian from Sri Lanka, went to the MFA Boston. That was my mistake. But Kumaraswamy kind of famously decoded and read these sculptures. So Shiva is about to perform a dance. It's a dark time. This very particular dance, and he performed a lot of them, but this one that we think of these sculptures as representing was made for really dark times. The end of the world, the Black Age. Things aren't working anymore. Congress isn't working anymore. it's a dark time, and that's when Shiva will come to perform this dance. And you'll know he's coming because you'll hear the rhythm of his dance from this little slap drum. And in this hand, he holds the fire the cleansing fire, the fire which the earth will be cleansed with. And it's a fire that flickers. It represents transience. And we're all a little scared at this point, right? But he's telling you, with this hand up, Abhaya Mudra, fear not, it will be okay. I'm here to cleanse the earth, to bring us out of this dark age and bring us back to a golden age. He stomps on a dwarf, not a baby, but a small dwarf, an impish figure, which is meant to represent ignorance, and he tramples ignorance. Come on, Shiva. We're ready for you. He is an amazing figure. And now I want you to walk around him. And go upstairs, if you haven't, to our galleries and walk around this sculpture, because it might be an icon that you view from the front, but he's incredible all the way around. He's completely sculpted. And here's this incredible balance then between somebody who is a god. They're perfect, right? Perfect proportions, perfectly balanced, unreal, idealized. Yet look at his little flesh around his hips. And a little bit here, and the other side you'll see kind of got, there's some breath there. And it's this blend of perfection, unworldly, unhuman perfection, and our humanness in these sculptures that makes them so amazing. They're also amazing in terms of technology. So he's about 3 feet high. He's solid bronze. Hundreds and hundreds of pounds. He's not going anywhere. You shouldn't be able to do that. The Greeks didn't sculpt like that. The Chinese didn't cast bronze like that. They didn't do that in Europe for large pieces like this. It shouldn't work. It should crack. It should have bubbles in it. Can you imagine the mastery, the alchemy that was going on in these forges 1,000 years ago in India to make a perfect sculpture like this? And this is why Chola bronzes are in the list of world history among one of the greatest art forms that ever was developed. This is our piece up against Cleveland's Nataraja. Cleveland still has its mandorla of flame. It's a little bit earlier, and it's believed to be an imperial one, probably from Tanjore. You can see how similar in style ours is, so I wouldn't be surprised if ours is originally from the Tanjore region as well. I think it gives Cleveland a run for its money, which is it's a stunning sculpture, both of them. And in its original context, you would see it in a shrine, under worship in a sub-shrine, dressed. You would never see it nude the way that we see it in a museum. Being cared for by a priest who helps you negotiate your prayers. And then these portable bronzes are also taken out during festivals, put on temple carts, and processed around these temple cities. And this is actually a festival in Chidambaram. So that's the great temple of Nataraja, one of the bronzes being processed in that photograph. But you can see the bronze upstairs in our beautiful 18th century Indian temple room. And in that room is another bronze. I just want to quickly talk about a few more works, but you know, he's incredibly important. She probably is more important because she is one of three great bronzes of the saint Karakal Amayar outside of India. Incredibly rare. And she, even in this form, this very abstract form. Look at her ribs, her skeletal appearance, her wild eyes, her fangs. You think, gosh, this is some sort of demigod or demon or fierce deity. And she's depicted like that as an icon, but she was a real woman in the 6th century. She was a woman who became a saint, and she is revered as the first of the Nayamars, which is a group of early saints in South India who were dedicated to Shiva. So she's the founding saint in that group. She was devoted to Shiva throughout her life, and when she was a young wife, she experienced a miracle, like saints in the Western tradition. Her husband had bought 2 mangoes, had them sent home. He was a merchant, sent them to the house, told her she needed to get them ready for his lunch. So they were at the house, she was cooking, and she got a knock at the door. And it was an old, shriveled, poor ascetic. And he asked for food, and she had no food except for the prized mangoes that her husband sent. And she looked at him, and he was a devotee of Shiva, and she felt something, and she gave him one of the mangoes. Knowing, and if any of you have ever had mangoes in India when they come into season, you will know what a big deal that is to give away. You wait all year for that. So the ascetic leaves. She's fed him. But now she's fearful. Oh, no, what about my husband? So he comes home for lunch, has a mango, and says, that was wonderful. Bring the next one. She thought, oh, damn it. She probably didn't say that. She's a saint, right? That's how I would think. And she goes back into the kitchen, and miraculously, another one is produced for her hands, which she brings to feed her husband. And he says, my God, that's better than the last one. Shiva created that mango because Shiva was the ascetic who came to her in disguise. And this miracle, being touched by Shiva, just brought out her devotion even more. She will eventually leave her husband and her family and become a wandering ascetic, and she travels up to the Himalayas on foot to Mount Kailash, the home of Shiva, and back to Tamil Nadu. And she establishes herself in a hut on the edge of a city where she's considered kind of an old wise woman or a witch. You don't want to get, she's a little scary. And she's physically transformed. She describes herself in her writings because she was a singer and a composer of devotional songs and poetry. So we have this body of text from her from the 6th century. I have an excerpt of it here because you'll see some of this devotional writing seems to describe her or her vision of herself. So a female ghoul with withered breasts and bulging veins, hollow eyes, white teeth, shriveled stomach, red hair, and 2 fangs. Bony ankles and elongated shins, stays in this cemetery howling angrily. This place where my lord dances in the fire with a cool body, his streaming hair flying in the 8 directions, Tiruvallankattu. Wow. And so the iconography, she's been turned from a living person into an icon, just like Shakyamuni centuries earlier. And her form, though, isn't the idealized, perfect body of a Buddha. It's the wizened body of a saint. Now, we just have 2 more things to look at, but one of them, I have to take you out of India for a brief minute, to Southeast Asia to travel with our saint, because she surprisingly becomes an iconographic form of great importance in Cambodia. And we see her depicted in early Khmer temples. So this is one of the lintels from the temples of Banti Shrey, 10th century temples, but they may have had work additions for the next two centuries. And here's Shiva dancing. And look who is watching him. Incredible. And while we're at Bhante Shrey, I just want to show you one of my favorite sculptures upstairs. It's small, it's unassuming. You might not assume, you know, as you're in there, that it's the most important thing. But this little relief is part of a lintel to a temple similar to Bhante Shrey, in the same style, probably from the same time, the same stylistic idiom. And I want you to look at the carving. Sandstone, look how deeply they had to drill to get these undulating water and foliage to come out like lettuce leaves and lay over top of each other. Incredible skill, incredible energy in one of the most magical periods of art in Southeast Asia. I want to show you a painting. This is a painting called Ramkali Ragini. It's a group of from a set of what we call Ragamala paintings. Ragamala is a term for a series of musical melodies, a collection of musical modes and melodies. And the music gave rise to a whole aesthetic kind of tradition in India, where poetry was composed in relation to the music and paintings were made. So this is our painting of Ramkali, which tells the story of a repentant lover and an angry beloved. And we see this story in various ragamalas. This was a very popular form of Indian painting, a very popular subject, and so we have sets that are painted across to India over the past 500-600 years. So here's a version, and you see the man coming to the woman here, and she's very abstract looking. She's turned away in disgust. Don't talk to me. Where were you? Here, from Bikaner in Rajasthan, kind of a similar version, very Mughal-influenced painting, where he's reaching down to touch her foot and she looks away. Now look at ours. Look at this beautiful pavilion. There's a bed, there's beautiful linens, embroideries, silk laid out in this grove of fruit overlooking a river. And where was he? And she was waiting for him. And here's her maid, often the go-between, between the lover and the beloved. And he comes, and it's different than the other paintings. She's not just disgusted looking away. Look at her shove his head down to her foot. The most polluted part of the body. And to touch someone's foot, to bow your head to it, that's something you do to a saint, to your guru, to your father, to your grandfather. That's such a diminutive, belittling act to you in Indian tradition. And she forces that upon her cheating lover. Beautifully painted. Look at the detail. Every leaf, the ripe fruit, the blooming flowers. And look at the background. Across the river, up the hill, is an ascetic's retreat. Here's the guru with his students, male and female. And look at this. In the background further, there's a fortress up on the rocks. This painting is from the Deccan in South India. Maybe from Hyderabad, very likely from Hyderabad. Outside of Hyderabad is the old fort of Golconda. Look at the rocks and the architecture. The care this artist put into this painting to render all these details, it's mind-boggling. So here's another painting we have from the series, a little less creative, maybe a little less accomplished, but it still has some of these wonderful hallmarks, like the palace up on those round rocks, the hills. And I love this. Look at these celestial goddesses bathing in the water to the right. And those apsaras, those goddesses, will take us to our last image, who, like Shiva, I think is one of our icons here at the Nelson-Atkins, a beautiful sculpture of a celestial nymph, apsara. And she's probably a very particular one of these class of goddesses. There's a subgroup that are called Surasundaris, which mean the beautiful beings, the beautiful goddesses. And a text that's about 600 years old, the Shilpa Prakasha, describes some of these Surasundaris. And Guntana is to be depicted from the back. She covers herself with a veil, or maybe tries to. She stands firm and her left leg is straight. That's her. But incredible. You know, there was that slight bend in the Gupta bronze sculpture, right? That little sway. Now we're at what we would call medieval Indian art, and everything's moving. Everything's bent, everything sways. It's a celebration of the body, it's a celebration of movement. It's incredible sculpture. And here, why is she bending and over and twisting? Because this is a little monkey here pulling off her dress. Very cute. Now this comes from Khajuraho, central India. This map shows you, it's located right here. It was the capital of a small dynasty in central India called the Chandelas. And so this is before they had borders. They were a tributary to this big dynasty here at 900. But this became their capital as they became a kind of kingdom in their own right. And in their capital, it's said that they had hundreds of temples at one time. And the group right near the center of town, what we call the Western group, there are probably like 15 surviving temples. And that's where you would find the celestial goddesses. So this is Kandariya Mahadev Temple, right around 1,000 of the Common Era. And notice along the bottom, you just find ornate patterns, and they're rather plain. Up at the top, as they reach toward the heavens, the decoration becomes very abstract. But it's in this middle realm that you find human beings and deities and demigods as they descend from the heavens to take roost upon the temples. Now, Khajuraho temples are very famous for this imagery. And if we go back, I just want to show you this. Do you see these spaces in between where the different parts of the temple come together? That's where you find this imagery. So if you Google Khajuraho, you're going to see all sorts of things. You're going to think the sculptures, you know, are that the temples are just completely covered with sensual and sexual imagery. It's actually very little against a whole pantheon of the universe that's on the temple. But they're very famous for these figural sculptures. And they're in these points where the building comes together. And it's really interesting because when the two parts of the building come together, the male and the female gods come together. And that's probably part of the reason they're there. So this is how you see our sculpture in the galleries and in publications, our Apsara. But that's not how you were meant to see her. Notice she's looking down and she turns her back to you. She was probably a corner figure, one of these figures here, who sat on a corner bracket, twisting, looking down at you and out. So that's a little better. You're still a little too high. But, you know, we look at this and we think, my gosh, that's beautiful, but it's very sexual, isn't it? I mean, it's really, she's voluptuous and it's revealing, and gosh, I mean, it must have meant something different. They must not have known how this would be interpreted. And I'm here to prove to you they knew exactly how this would be interpreted. This is a text from the 12th century. It was written by a monk from the Jain tradition, Ramachandragani. And here in his text that describes the wonderful temple that a Gujarati king built in the 12th century, he tells us, there in that temple, the statue of a lady who struggled to hold fast to her girdle as a monkey untied its knot, made young gallants feel desire, and confirmed the steadfast in their rejection of sensual delights. It disgusted the pious. It made old ladies feel embarrassed, while it made young men laugh and young girls wonder. The emotional impact of that sculpture is similar to us today as it was to the viewers and visitors of that temple in the 12th century. And it was intentional, because Indian art is full. The Indic traditions reach all of your senses, all of your feelings, and they connect you and the human world to the divine world. And so I hope we leave tonight with seeing the works from a different point of view and seeing the works in a new light. Thank you. Okay. I'm happy to take questions. I'm also happy to talk with people outside, and I encourage you to go look at the book. And we have some wonderful Indian events coming up this year in celebration of India's 70th year of independence. So we have Passport to India coming up April 9th. We have a special kind of evening cooking event on April 7th. And probably a very special, we're confirming a special concert at the end of June, June 30th. So we'll have a year of India to celebrate. I'm looking forward to seeing a lot of you here. Thank you. That's a great question, and feel free if you don't need to stay for the answers. Asian art is often an anonymous art. There certainly are sculptors and workshops. Sometimes we can identify them by shared maker's marks between sculptures. At this period, we usually don't have names of artists, but we often do, particularly in the later periods, some of the painting schools and painting artists we know by name. All right, one more. They're often, protected. You know, if they're under worship, they're frequently bathed and cleansed. If they're stored and have been protected, they're they've been kept well, and so it really depends on the conditions of how they've been kept. That bronze corrosion that you'll see is natural, and if it was buried and exposed to earth at some point, it usually is more corroded than a piece that's been under worship longer or just in its environment, maybe it luckily didn't get exposed to the earth. So you're seeing natural corrosion. To my knowledge, we haven't done major conservation on it. I think it's just still in very good condition. All right, thank you, and have a great, great Asian weekend.